disruptive to your own immune system, because COVID was a serious disease, and then you didn't just want to rely on remedies that don't exactly work. But we braved through that storm, and kudos to the Ugandans who put in all they could to make sure that Ugandans do get some options other than the vaccine, which vaccination exercise, which wasn't going so well. So, but again, even up to now, I think Ugandans that are vaccinated have just probably hit 10 or 20%. I think those are the current estimates right now. And it does beg the question as to how at what level we're going to be, like, we've probably covered enough to start on relying maybe on herd immunity or something like that. The vaccinations, even down here in the states where we are, they're not getting anywhere beyond, I think, the 65-67% rate at the moment. And some of the reason as to why it is, it's been a challenge for most countries to reach 100%, I think, to my observation, is we have people who are not included in the scope of a immunizable population. Because if you look at the newborns or children that are below maybe 12 or 15 years or so, those I think have were not meant to be subjected to the COVID vaccine. The COVID vaccine was mostly given to the elderly, and then of course the frontline workers or the essential workers, and the rest of the population, which includes the young children, most of the young children and those with other issues in regards to vaccines, maybe those would come in later after more and deeper research has been done. But that's where we stand at the moment. It might not be possible to achieve 100% immunization globally or even per country. And even for those that have done so well, like you cited Israel, which is probably 90%, still they reach the population which isn't covered. But we do hope that as efforts go on with more research being done, and of course looking into the feedback we're getting from the immunized population, we can make better decisions on where to direct this, because it just looks like with the MOVA mutations that come in for the virus, from COVID itself, the harder it is even to understand which trajectory, whether we have made good decisions in the past, and or we can rely on the shots that we took, the vaccine we took, to protect us into the next variant and the next variant, which is a question which the medical community is probably in position to answer or give us at least some kind of direction on that note. But other than that, we do hope that, if you're safe, you continue protecting yourself, your loved ones, and of course, obey all the SOPs, mask on, and of course, do the vaccine if you can, and then try also the natural remedies that were, that were put out on the market. But of course, you have to do that with some direction. If it's possible, you should consult a health worker before you get into all these functions that were on the market. I think it was like so many YouTube videos and audio notes circulating on social media, as in to the alternatives to the vaccine or the medication for COVID. And some of these could have been actually more detrimental to health. So that's why I think it would get back to you as a person to protect your health. Try to make some consultations, wider consultations, other than just listening into what remedies are out there that anyone is selling, people who even have no medical background or, you know, in anything, any training in health, human health, are actually pushing out. So it's all on you to do your due diligence, to research, and then take up whatever remedy direction you want to go with. But away from COVID, we did have, following the untimely death of the Tanzanian president, Joseph Magufuli, we did have the new president elect, even before ascension, you know, to the seat, sign the oil deal with the Ugandan government at that point, which was supposed to pave way to the construction of the heated oil pipeline all the way from Uganda and through Tanzania and all the way down to the coast. This was an interesting development, and one that yes, people, at least the economists, did welcome. And of course, there are so many lingering questions there, as in to whether this was done in good faith or Uganda has a fair share of this contract at the end of the day. Just through a few specifics of the contract that were in there. It was to cost about 3.5 billion. And Uganda and Tanzania are supposed to collaborate and, you know, fund this project together. Now, I'm not sure how this is going to go, because I think we've had a few regional projects. Like, I think we have the East African Gauge Railway project, where I think Kenya did its part and then Uganda was yet to do its part. Now, I am hoping that this time around, when it comes to this oil pipeline, because a lot is at stake, we do pull our own weight and do contribute our fair share to funding this project. Of course, better answers would come from the minister, you know, the Ministry of Finance, on how they intend to go about this. But this is by far going to be probably one of the longest crude pipelines or heated pipelines in the world. It is going to be about 800 miles, or just about 1,400 kilometers. That's a very, very, very long distance. And looking at the dynamics of a heated pipeline, it's not like you're constructing just a water pipeline from one end to the other. The whole pipeline has to be heated. There's a lot of technology that has to be used along the way. And I'm hoping we have taken time to train some good engineers. I know we're partnering with the Chinese, and I hope they do have good solutions to this and how we're going to realize this. We can at least at the end of the day just accept that it's going to be a challenge, and a challenge that we already assented to in a contract, and we have to see it through to the finish. But on the flip side, we had a good number of NGOs that did actually advocate for defunding the pipeline. They were not interested in funding the pipeline. And I think this is purely because of environmental concerns, because globally, as you might know, oil is becoming something that the world doesn't put as the number one source of energy or livelihood. So there is a drift towards renewable energies, or towards, you know, electrification. Like you can see, there's so many hybrid cars that they're trying to push out. There are EPA standards that nations are trying to adhere to. Like you had, this scandal of, I think it was VW, which was cheating. It had the cheat device for its emissions test, and that really cost them a big deal here in the States, whereby all their cars are to be recalled for a good number, because they were polluting the environment. Now, this is what is happening on this other side. And of course, there's a lot of investment in electric cars globally. I do understand that Uganda is trying to do that with, I think, the Kira EV Moto Corporation, which was set up a few years ago after, you know, a few students from Makerere did come up with, you know, some prototypes for electric vehicles. We're yet to see a good number of those and get to the transport sector. They're doing a lot of marketing more so on Facebook. I don't know if they're doing it on Facebook yet. I think Facebook is still shut down in Uganda. I don't know whether it's marketing to those who are outside Uganda yet. I think it's Ugandans that need them. That's up to you to also think about. But at least they are trying to take strides in giving Uganda a direction as far as you know, energy needs, transportation needs are concerned. A while back, I think the Kayola bus was one day even taken to the UN to transport a few delegates. So they are really trying to make the headways. The engineers at Kira are trying to make good strides there for the country. But of course, the question would be at the end of the day, after these buses are being, you know, or the whichever vehicles we have, because I think they have sedans and they have the buses, after these are put on the market, will Ugandans be able to afford them? And, you know, what is our production capacity at the end of the day? What will repairs look like at the end of the day? Those are questions that I'm sure the engineers down there are trying to answer, and I hope we get these cars on the road to replace the so many old cars that we have that usually are even unsafer on, you know, for users more so in the developed countries where they are offloaded then dumped in our economies. But away from the oil pipeline, we hope something nice comes of it. We'll see more developments in this year and you know, more to come. But we did have the Ugandan and Rwanda border closed at we did have the truck drivers going to South Sudan do get on a strike at some point. You know, Sudan is a good trading partner with Uganda, but we did see some bit of insecurity on the borders whereby, and I think this also came up due to the lockdown measures that came up because people are not doing anything. So you're bound to have a few people who are going to use this time to just do mayhem in order to earn something. So they're going to get into acts of criminology, trying to, you know, rip off those who are seemingly running stable businesses during the lockdown, because we can argue that a good percentage of the population was locked down, and yes, they didn't have anything to, you know, to rely on. Now, we did see that happening along the Uganda South Sudan border, where, you know, truck drivers were getting attacked, and they had to get onto a strike and hold trade for a while. But and I hope you know, both governments did come in to try to stabilize the environment for trade, because one of the biggest reasons we need peace and a stable working environment is that commerce can continue to take place. And the reason you need commerce is because it's what runs people's livelihood. People need to access goods, people need to you know, get inputs for their businesses and all that. So this was critical. And looking at the fact that South Sudan is a member of the East African Community, as Rwanda is, and I think we did also have the Rwanda border also closed at some point. And, you know, this makes you wonder whether the realization, the goal of the East African Community is even going to be a feasible one when we are having all these roadblocks along the way, or things that just seem to distract us from the progress. Yes, you've signed an oil deal with Tanzania. That's good. Regional cooperation is happening right there. We have a lot of trade happening between us and Nairobi. and Kenya. Then when it comes to Rwanda, we're closing the borders. But then what is interesting is that Rwanda does export more to Uganda than Uganda does. And that is shown in, you know, the full export index of Rwanda. But closing the border, I was thinking that maybe it is the Rwandese who would be losing, because they are exporting more through us. I don't know how they landed onto that conclusion. We're yet to find out why there was all these developments came up at that time that, you know, borders were closed. And up to now, it is unclear whether, you know, we're fully open for business, or what is open for business within, you know, Rwanda and Uganda. It seems to be a kind of war going on there, which is not so clear to the public as to why it is happening. But maybe we shall get more answers when it comes to this year, with more developments coming up. Of course, lastly, I would want to end with the Kenyan government rejecting some of the exports from Uganda, more so from the poultry products, eggs, and we know there's a lot of there's so many Ugandans who are relying on poultry for their livelihood, and they've commercialized it, have scaled it big to be able to export. Now, if you have a trading partner like Kenya not accepting your products, maybe because they have enough of those in their country, then of course this is not going to be so good for those traders who are in that space. We had, I think, a few people within, the Ugandan poultry, I think it was, it is a unifying body for the poultry farmers, trying to, lobby the government to try to find a way out of this situation where, you know, the Kenyans are rejecting our products. And God knows how this is going to play out come this year and so on, with us trying to realize the bigger idea of regional trade. If we're running into these issues, yes, you're having insecurity in South Sudan, the Rwandese are closing the borders, then the Kenyans are refusing your products. I think we need to do more work on those fronts to see that we streamline everything such that we do not get our farmers and businessmen are stranded with their products, yet they are trying to serve the wider community, or the wider, you know, the, all the people within, you know, within East Africa per se. So I think those are some of the issues I can dwell on as to the highlights of 2021. And I would want to turn the floor back to you, Nordin.
Thank you very much, Lawrence. Thank you very much. You know, what is really very interesting when you're trying to highlight most of those events, it's like they happened yesterday. Some of them happened in the middle of the year, but because of the impact they have put on the people and the way people think, look at them as a menace to possibly having a good life, then it becomes so close and so near to what we are on right now. Very much, Lawrence. Thank you. I'll bring in again Stephen. Yes, Stephen.
Yes, Dr. Joko.
Yes, you've heard what Lawrence has tried to give out. He's been driving us through the events, and most pertinent was the borders where the trade could, you know, thrive. We are being tampered with. I mean, like people, the truck drivers went in strike for Sudan border, like the Kenyan rejecting our Ugandan eggs in revenge of impounding Kenyan fish, like Rwanda border, which still remains up to date closed. All these are really impediment to the economic growth of our country. Let's go ahead and look at the law. What happened with Uganda when it came to Congo? What was the background to Uganda going to Congo?
Thank you so much, Dr. Juko. And I once again salute my listeners. I appreciate my brother Lawrence for that deep analysis of the events as they happened in Uganda. When you look at the background of Uganda launching an operation against the ADF in Congo, it comes way back in the month of June when General Edward Katumba Wamala got an attack. Unfortunately, he lost the daughter and the driver, but thank God he survived. Now, from that day on, it was believed that this attack was planned by the ADF terrorists, and the climax of this was the October-November bomb blasts that were let out in the Kampala city. Now, it was this that acted as a litmus and created an engagement between the leaders of these two countries, the leader of Uganda and then the leader of Congo, where the two agreed to pursue the ADF. Of course, ADF is not the only rebel group that is in Congo. There are so many, like the Mai Mai, previous used to have the Nyamlenge. There is even another group known as the Lendu. At one time, they even attacked northwestern part of Uganda. They attacked people of Koboko, and they were repulsed. When these events happen, of course, there's been so many heinous attacks that has happened in Uganda, the killing of those sheikhs was also attached to them, the killing of Joan Kagezi, the death of my brother, who was the Assistant Inspector General of Police, Andrew Felix Awesi, all these other gruesome murders that has been taking place in town, they have been attached to these ADF rebels. Now, this was the climax and the background information that created an opportunity for the two leaders to agree that eventually Uganda attacks the enemy from his enemy bases, from his bases in Congo. So the month, so towards the end of November, 30th of November, if I may be exact, the UPDF launched an attack against the ADF in Congo. The information that we got there and the information that we get today, that because of the impenetrable vegetation that is there, they went with bulldozers to clear the way. They went with road units. They opened roads that will now enable them access those enemy camps. And from the briefing that Uganda was given by the army spokesperson, that close to 60 ADF soldiers surrendered to the Congolese army around 4 to 5 ADF bases were demolished, they were attacked and demolished, and many of these rebels were scattered. And recently the president was telling us that UPDF is pursuing them wherever they are scattered from. Now, of course, that is one of the reasons, but of course, the main reason why Uganda got so much interested, just like it has always been, the policeman, the region. It is more economic than political or that security. Because when you look at the trade balance between Uganda and Congo, you'll discover that even in this abnormal situation, Uganda earns over 200 million from our trade with the Congo, $200 million. And Uganda or Congo receives, on the other hand, only $20 million. So you'll discover that when you look at the trade balance between the two countries, Uganda benefits more. Now, even it benefits more amidst that insecure economic environment. So I believe the main reason why Uganda moved on to pacify that region, Uganda believes that if it can concentrate and can pacify that area, it can benefit more dollars and in the trade between Uganda and Congo than in the trade between Uganda and maybe other neighbors like Kenya. Of course, the behavior of Kenya and the behavior of Tanzania and then the behavior of Rwanda by closing borders, it gives Uganda an opportunity now to look westwards. To look westwards. And I believe it is one of the reasons why Uganda was forced to pursue the ADF, to try to pacify that area. We are all aware that whereas the Congo government is supposed to establish authority there, but there is no authoritative government in that area. There is no authority. And it's the reason why some of these rebel groups are thriving in that area, because the government of Congo in Kinshasa does not have firm authority and control over those other areas. So it is the reason why now Uganda is trying to come in to try to create, to fill the vacuum of leadership and authority and control, to try to pacify the area and try to make an economic or business sense in that area. We believe that if the entire area of Kisangani, Goma, Ituri, and others are really pacified and there is that smooth flow of goods, Uganda can earn thousands of dollars from the relationship between the two countries than it would have received from either Kenya or Tanzania. And it is the very reason why Uganda was forced to go to South Sudan to try to create peace there so that we can try to engage in economic activities between the two countries. So that is ADF. And leaving ADF alone, you'll discover that Uganda has also of recent launched the parish development model. It was also launched. Now, the government of Uganda believes that by reorganizing the communities into this kind of economic model, economic approach, it will spur development because under this model, government is planning to inject 300 million Ugandan shillings per every parish. And it is also believed that in the parish, people may create circles that would benefit themselves, circles where communities would manage those funds, create development activities that would develop them. So, of recent, of course, this was part of the NRM manifesto, and of recent has been launched. But of course, the funding is not yet out. According to the recent information by the State Minister for Finance, Honorable Amos Gorobi, the funding for the parish model will come out in between March and April of 2022. So it was launched virtually, but of course practically it has not been launched. Why? Because the resources to finance this approach has not yet been released. Leave alone that in the month of December, we also witnessed the strike by the medical interns. Remember, medical interns, these are medical practitioners, these are medical students who are about to finish their course in medicine. Many of them start their practice in hospitals in their third years, fourth years, and mainly fifth years. Now, during that period, they fill in so many gaps. They fill in so many gaps, and previously they had a complaint that they were doing most of the done work in the hospitals. The government had promised to reimburse and uplift their salaries, their earnings. Now, it is unfortunate that by the time they decided to go on a strike, they had waited for so long. And it was this, even after meeting the president, they went to present their petition to the parliament. So it was in the process of delivering that petition that police as usual, the Ugandan police, which is called the Ugandan police force, as usual impounded on them, arrested some of them, bruised them as usual, and the consequence of that was the medical director, who, of course, unrealistically wrote firing letters, firing all of them, but because he was not living close to reality, his firing letter remained with him because there is no way practically he would fire these guys. There is no way, because when he tried to attempt it, even the real medical doctors, the qualified ones, joined the group, joined the fight, and eventually the medical director lost the battle. So that was one was also trendy, and eventually the president called these guys, and together with the Minister of Finance, and they agreed to pay them before Christmas. What came out of that meeting was eventually we heard that these interns were never paid what they expected. They had expected to be paid 2.5 million. Unfortunately, on reaching on their account, they found 1.5. And that one also caused a lot of uproar. So that one was also trendy. Another event that trended 2021 was the appointment of the new IGG, Madame Betty Kamia Traore, replacing Justice Muliya Gonja. Of course, she did not directly replace Muliya Gonja. Justice Muliya Gonja's tenure of service had expired long before, and she was tentatively replaced by George Bamugemere, who was her deputy. We thought that it would be an automatic promotion, that Mr. George Bamugemere, the husband of Catherine Bamugemere, automatically would become the next ombudsman. It was, I think, a very big shock for him, but eventually the president preferred a politician who was not a lawyer to take over that political office. Now, for the last few months that Betty Kamia has been in office, of course, a lot has happened. She has tried to bring scares to the thieves, but of course she has been warned. The first disappointment that she got was when the president warned her openly to go slow on the Ugandan money thieves. It was an open statement when the president warned her that the good thing with the Ugandan corrupt people or individuals is that when they steal the money, they reinvest it here. So she warned her to go slow, not to scare away the thieves, for they would run out with her money and then invest it elsewhere. So, of course, that one attracted a lot of debate and a lot of responses from those who looked at the president as a patron of thieves. They looked at him as a personality who is not bent to fight corruption. Of course, as we speak today, Madame Beth Kamia is already knocking, rubbing shoulders with so many people. As we speak, there is a clash between her and the director of public procurement and disposal of government assets, Canon Turami, I think Canon Turami. There is a very serious conflict between where the IGG is probing an investigation over over National Water and Sewage Corporation. There was a procurement process that did not follow the process which Madame Kamia wanted to be investigated. That one has already brought a clash between her and Canon Turami, and of course with others. So that is what is now happening in the office of the Inspector General of Government. One of the things that she made clear was to bring to the notice of Ugandans that every year Uganda loses over 10 trillion in the hands of the corrupt. This was very, very, very scary. 10 trillion Ugandan shillings lost in the hands of the corrupt. Very, very worrying. You can imagine what the 10 trillion can do if well preserved. The areas of education would have super structures and would have the best education system all over Africa. In terms of hospitals, would have the best hospitals with 10 trillion. In terms of physical infrastructures like roads, would seize after 5 years, after one Chisanja, would seize to have any Maram road in Uganda with 10 trillion reserved every year from the hands of the corrupt.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Just hold you from on there. We had also a very interesting story that is about the Kabaka of Buganda.
Yes.
who was very angry when it came to people that are corrupt, and that many of the people that were much of the money that was being lost was too much basically within the areas of Buganda. So let's have that video first, and then we go ahead. I'll bring in Lawrence to, you know.
Tubasaba okwongera amaanyi okukuutira abantu baffe okulwanyisa ebikolwa byonna eby'obuli bw'enguzi obw'engeri yonna obuzingamizza obuweereza obw'enjawulo okutuuka ku bantu baffe. Newankubadde abantu bangi batulowoozesa nti enguzi eri ku kuwuttanya nsimbi za muwi wa musolo, kino si kituufu. Waliwo n'ebintu ebirala bingi ebigendererwa okulaba nti omuntu asukkuluma ku munne engeri abantu gye baweebwamu emirimu nayo yeeraliikiriza okulaba ng'abalina ebisaanyizo basigalira oluusi ne giweebwa abalina ebitawera oba abatalina ddala.
Thank you very much, our producer. There is also, before I bring you, Lawrence, there was also another video I wanted to play, our producer to play for us, which was about the launched operation of the ADF. Would you, our producer, play for us that one? And also the issue of the interns. Okay, as the producer tries to get that video. Lawrence, there is you haven't talked about the issue of the general. Did you talk about the issue of General Paul Lokech, which was very shocking, and his death because he had just talked about eliminating people from those that he was talking about that were hitting bombs, and he had killed a lot of them, as they say, putting them out of action. And it very soon it happened, and everybody was wondering what happened.
Yeah, of course we haven't discussed that, but just to get straight to that, when you look at the demise that, our dear and brother, fallen brother Lokech, went through at that point. I think it's just a first. It's just a clear cut example of our, immortality. At the end of the day, you might have a position, and then you can make all these shots and make all these statements, but you do not know when death is going to visit you. I mean, it's coming for all of us. That's the only known fact or certainty we have after birth. The rest of everything that happens in between is purely an accident, as some philosophers say. So yes, he did come out to boast to cornering all these rogue elements and taking them out in action. And, just a few months after that, or days, he's met with his own death. So, again, it is shocking, of course, that it happens just at the time when he's making these threats, and more so in the face of ADF. And, of course, then that continues the discussion of as to whether this is also part of the reasons, precursor to Uganda making an offensive in the DRC. If that is the reason, then maybe if at all there's some other untold story here, which of course this is pure speculation, that ADF did indeed attack or rather take general or rather major Lokech out of action, whether maybe this is what prompted us to actually add to our intelligence and then make an offensive in the DRC. Maybe that's a good thing, maybe.
Yeah, Lawrence, before you go ahead, let's have the videos first, and then you have a very good way of handling it. Let's have the videos. Okay.
Arrived early morning at the Secretariat of the Commission of Land Inquiry, Federation of Uganda Medical Interns.
The doctors said they would not avail themselves to the different hospitals assigned unless government increases their pay.
The Kingdom's Attorney General David Mpanga. The Buganda Premier was accompanied by a delegation of dignitaries from the Kingdom, including Prince David Wasajja Chintu, Third Deputy Katikkiro Apollo Makuya, and officials of the Buganda Land Board. Key among the Kingdom's concerns was what was seen as part of the interim
also
recommendations
of the Commission
of Land Inquiry to abolish the Milo land tenure system that is predominant in Buganda.
With so unclear student salary, no stipulated time of payment,
Thirdly,
and the terms and conditions under which
in a country.
in are not clear.
I hope you do go back with a message.
So that this we have agreed that we are not going to pick those appointment letters
and we until they are revised.
Uganda has many problems, and someone can argue
almost,
that
it's only this that like the world, like to the Bible.
This commission has tried as much as possible to safeguard Buganda land borderlands, safeguard Kabaka's land.
Maiga also said Mengo opposes the proposed amendment of the Land Act to allow government compulsorily acquire private land before compensation. Instead, he urged government to promptly compensate landowners, improve efficiency in the land office, and check corruption.
The end, so we can restore security and peace in the region.
The Congolese hope is the last, but it certainly isn't the first. Here is a joint UN and Congolese task force.
He said weak policies and institutions are responsible for the persistent and widespread land problem.
I think, sorry for the interruption. Lawrence, the issue of the red card was a very... exciting news where people possibly could be rejuvenated with after a big loss into the during the election. They had lost a lot and all people's kind of vigor had gone down. What is your analysis about the launch of the red card campaign that was done by Besigye, and how impactful was it on the political scene of Uganda?
Well, thank you so much, Nadine, for that question. When it comes to the issue of the red card, I think the red card campaign, I think we did have Honorable Mavike come to grace us with his presence so as to articulate some of the issues and the vision of this front in as far as the political atmosphere is concerned in Uganda. The views are well received, and I think they do touch every other concern that all other political parties or initiatives do have in Uganda, more so in NUB and FDC and all the other parties at hand. The wish that the red card was had is, of course, or has even up to now, is to try to create more participation and involvement of the public into political matters, which of course is needed, putting in mind that we had just suffered a very bloody loss down in the January election, where of course NUP did not win, and the whole process was mud in a lot of irregularities, and most people are not happy with that. And of course, the withdrawal of the court case that we had to appeal the decision of the EC further crushed the spirits and minds of the Ugandans. So there was, or there is, a need that the Red Card Front was trying to address there, to try to rejuvenate or rekindle the political flame among the population. But of course, now the main issue is just looking at how effective or how far this campaign is going to go. Is it, just a foreplay for, 2026? Is it trying to realize some of those changes within this presidential term? How long, what is the short term and long term plans for this syndicate? And of course, most Ugandans who are politically awake know the issues, the patriot issues, which is corruption, land, too much excessive power that is abused by some of the those people who hold it, unfair distribution of certain resources and positions. All these issues are, part of the Red Card Front, as they are part of, NUB and all the other political parties. But I think it is still a question of time. We can give this time to see how you know, what the future holds for some of these initiatives. Like, for instance, if you are to ask, is the Red Front, does the Red Front have, a seat on iPod, for instance, because, you know, it took a lot of effort to come up with the iPod. And we can all agree that it has not really gone the way the architects thought it would, because I think so many times the strongest opposition figures or parties tend to boycott iPod, yet it is one of the platforms that was put to kind of level the ground, whereby, you know, the incumbent is supposed to come in and all these other views come, you know, are shared on the same round table, and then, you know, you get resolution such that you might avoid alterations or, conflicts on the street and elsewhere. That hasn't been effectively used. So I just intend to just see maybe how far the card front will go when it comes to this year and, you know, time to come. We should, of course, see them by their actions, and it's only time. It's only time to tell. But, of course, I just felt like there were so many good times in the campaign, the likes of Mabike himself, and of course Dr. Kizza Besigye, who has run for the presidential race for, you know, three or four times over, it still goes back to the one of the biggest issues that Ugandans are wrestling with at the moment, which is, at what point are people supposed to retire? So many times we do have an age for civil servants to retire, but when it comes to people in politics, at what point do they retire? And maybe this is one of the reasons even as to why maybe the president doesn't want to leave his seat, because if he's sharing a government, or rather heading a government whereby you have a few MPs who have been in parliament for 30 years, I think even 40 years for some people, it is going to give him confidence that if someone else is doing it, then I can do it. And after all, I'm at the helm of all this. So people refusing to retire or hand over responsibility, leadership responsibilities to maybe a younger generation, or, you know, people they have groomed within their own parties, is questionable. And it is a concern as to when this stops, or what is the other plan. So I'm sure some Ugandans were concerned about that. And of course, that was expressed all over social media as to really have, you know, the concerns they did have for the Red Front. But let's see what happens this year, and maybe the coming years, maybe we shall be able to put them in at the right pedestal at the end of the day, just like the way when People Power started, and then it had to transition into the National Unity Platform. And right now, we're seeing that it is just gearing up to maybe the next election season, as you're observing. We just want to see what happens in that space. And we are hoping that either way, whatever happens, Ugandans do get a win out of how they are managed, and especially on those other elements or factors that are affecting them as a people. And maybe just to move to the other issue, which is the first video that our producer did roll, the issue of the Kabaka, you know, castigating the government on issues of corruption, nepotism, and all that, in his address to the Luchiko. I think this sends a very loud message and a very bold message to the government coming from Mengo. And it is no secret that Mengo does have a very big stake in as far as power sharing or influence is concerned, in Uganda. For instance, Mengo, of course, you know, is the headquarters of the Buganda, you know, leadership. And looking at Kampala, the, you know, BCD area, it contributes over 60% of the national, you know, GDP, or, you know, collections that the government makes from Uganda. That is huge. If it's over 50%, it's huge. Now, for an area which is even known to probably a quarter of the country, that is commendable. So if there are concerns to someone who is contributing over 50% of what you use to manage the rest of the country, I think that should be very, very well, and it really commands for some action. Putting people like Betty Kamya into IGG, amongst other appointments that have come in, and the new leadership that we have, yes, they do have a very big responsibility to Ugandans as to how affairs of the nation are going to be handled, and more so when it comes to some of these appointments, as they say. And I think it's not just political appointments that the Kabaka was talking about. It's positions or jobs or across the board from every other sector or every other office out there. It's no secret that these concerns have been voiced by the public, that so many times people are not chosen for jobs, they do not get the jobs they apply for, even despite having the best qualifications or even better qualifications than those who do get these jobs. It's questionable. It's very disgusting to be one who actually goes through this on the ground. Of course, it kills dreams, and it leads to very poor management, because if you put very incompetent people into certain offices, you're not going to get a good job, which is maybe the idea, to have incompetent people in certain positions such that then the filth can be propagated, and then resources can continue to be stolen the way they are. We're losing so much to corruption and the incompetence of most of the people who are in positions of power. So there's a very big war on that front which needs to be launched, and we're yet to see what actions are going to be taken. Of course, I don't expect so much on that front, because this has been ongoing for a while. It is very hard. It's not like it doesn't happen at all, but in Uganda it's so hard to, in most cases, get jobs on merit, even if it happens to certain people. But we'll see what action the government takes, or people themselves. And sometimes I question, and I'm like, it's not really something that we should always throw this to the government, because who is the government? The government is you and me. It's the people. We make it up. We shape the government. We are the people. I think it was Kanofelis Kolaije, when he was asked about all the violence that is happening within law enforcement, and he was like, he answered is like, it's you and me who put these people, who contribute to the forces. It's you who have groomed people so badly that they end up being this nature and all that. I think that is how that show went. So right now, if a concern like that has come up, that there is corruption, and as far as certain appointments are concerned, the question is, who's going to take action? We can't always just tend to throw it back to the government, because the government is you and me. It is everyone. It is people. So if at all these messages or this message can be taken personally by everyone who is in any position and try to make sure that they address the concerns that, this time it's, Kabaka of Buganda voiced this. So many times religious leaders have voiced all these concerns. Members of different, corporations or, non-government organizations and all those, they've expressed these concerns, and they're like, oh, people, it's not being done right. Now, to the people who are in these offices, yes, we can agree that sometimes the actors within the state, where contracts are supposed to go a certain way, and then someone jumps in and then they change the course of the contract award. That is happening. But if you are the person who is making these decisions, at the end of the day, how can you better protect or work? Are there forums for you to whistleblow in case someone is trying to achieve or certain orders are coming. Besides those directives that so many times come from the president, I think we've seen so many directives from the president to different agencies of who should be awarded what and all that. And maybe this is the modus operandi of how our nation is governed or is to be governed. It is not even corruption, it is just a way of life that some people are going to be put in certain positions based on how maybe the president or certain ministers or high-ranking officials feel about it. But if you are, what other forums do we have, or what options do you have as a civil servant or a person who is heading a ministry or a corporation that has the public interest? What options do you have? Is there any ethics and integrity training that is going on into most of these organizations? And I think it is, but when it comes to practice, it's something else. So it is not even a question of nothing is done. Something is done, but still things go the other way. And of course, that shows you how much of a responsibility Ugandans have to right some of the wrongs that other people are creating. And of course, it's even a bigger message to people in the Ministry of Justice, people who are into law enforcement. You are in the police, you are in the army. If you're using all this strength, for instance, to combat crowds when it comes to enforcing COVID-19 regulations, like we saw during the campaigns, why shouldn't you use the same vigor when it comes to enforcing justice if it is abused, in a certain office? It's a question of then what do they do? They're all just going to sit down. And I don't know whether they benefit from this or not. But we can't keep quiet. And I really applaud the different forums or agencies or organizations out there that try to put to try to get this conversation going, more so like the UNN is trying to miss all other partners and agencies out there that really want to see a better future for Uganda, better operation and management of affairs. And I think it's a big journey. It's a very big challenge as well to Ugandans, but we do hope that maybe someday we shall be able to get better results, or a reality that we all can be proud of as having built and having set up for future generations. Thank you so much, Dr. Duco.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lawrence. It has been a pleasure. I'll have a question, the last one, which I'll ask you as I ask it for. Let me ask it to Steve. Steve, are you on with us?
Yes, Dr. Joko.
Yes. One important question I would like to ask is, we have said it all, but I want you to tell us which three stories have you felt very interesting you think that they've been too much touching when it comes to the public?
Thank you so much. Of course, all those outlined trends are so much touchy that have shown so much in the limelight of Uganda's politics and economics. But the most outstanding one, the most three outstanding ones, the sham elections that we had in the month of January 14, 2021. It was a sham election because it was marred with brutality, police brutality. Very many young lives were killed. It was marred with bribery. And it was full of manipulation. And it was just a routine that every after 5 years, an election has to be organized where the incumbent has to legitimize his grip to power. There are so many things that have been happening over the years, over the past elections, I think right from 1996, we have never had a free and a fair election, because the right, any election should have several acceptable parameters. And that is why the right election should be free and fair. Now in Uganda, when it is an election, it is war. It is war. You would see police coming in, the red top coming in, and at most, the army that is meant to keep Uganda's borders from external aggression. Now, if reigning in against the people it should protect. And that's why in every election, there are very many people who get dissatisfied. They run to court. Court suggests a number of redresses. But it's like the story ends at, I mean, with the court. There are so many suggestions that have been put forth by the Supreme Court of Uganda to try to shatter the right elections. But it's very unfortunate that even in the recent elections that we had, the Supreme Court in 2016 had suggested a number of reforms before we'd have an election. But there was nothing that was brought forth. We had a repeat of the same, no reform, and at the end of it all, what should have been an election was laughable. The outcome was expected. No wonder the main opposition group could not accept it, just like it has always been, because
Stephen, your
of
second,
the obvious indicators.
Your second one.
Then, so that is the second one, of course, is the land issue. Just like you have given us the chronology of the various land acts and the land laws that have been enacted in Uganda, we still experience a lot of repression, evictions over land, especially in central Uganda. That even during the lockdown, the people wielding power had the audacity to evict people, even after the land minister, by then Bet Kamia, making a bylaw and order for the so-called land grabbers not unseat people. That one could not stop the land grabbers from evicting people. And to me, that was very, very unfortunate. We have a sitting government with all the instruments of authority, but it's very unfortunate that the people should have protected the plight of the people being unsettled from their land. They're simply lamenting. It was very unfortunate one time when I had the president lamenting over these people. And to make matters worse, most of these people victimizing these poor people, they're coming from state house, and many of them are Museveni's henchmen. So it is very unfortunate, and it is upon this that we need a very serious redress over this. This should stop.
The
land
one?
Issue should be handled. And then the third one, the third one, of course, I had Lawrence seriously expounding over it, and that is the issue of corruption that is almost killing this country. Recently, there was an opinion poll taken over the economic performance of the East African countries. Of course, they were voting the best leadership, and when you look at the seven East African countries, you'll discover that Kagame, a leader of a very small nation with a very small per capita income, was voted the best. The reason for this is because the the absorption capacity, the resource absorption capacity of these countries are compared, and eventually it was discovered that despite the limited resources that Rwanda has continued to fully utilize the resources, the meager resources compared to countries like Uganda. And what is killing Uganda? It is corruption. The second disease which is killing Uganda, it is corruption. And then the third disease that is killing Uganda in the hands of Sara Lwanyi, it is corruption. We have all these other institutions that are meant to fight corruption, but they are powerless, toothless, simply because the corrupt are sheltered by those in authority. And it is one of the worst things that has killed almost a full generation. Today, there is no public office you can go to and you don't give out what we call a kickback. If you want something to be done quickly, then you have to give a kickback. There is this common saying in the, one of the Ugandan dialects, gende kasao. Gende kasao means see how you can reach out your hand into your pocket and then quicken the process. If you want to see how dangerous corruption is, you go even to these other public schools, the so-called first world schools. If you want a place for your child, you'll have to bribe somebody. That is how dangerous it has reached.
Yes.
A police officer will stop you.
Yes, you should wind up, Steve.
Even when you have everything that your cash should have, but you will find an opportunity to pull out something from you. Now, corruption in Uganda, why it is very dangerous, it has taken a normal trend. Nobody seems to bother. It is the norm of the day. And that one is very dangerous. And that's why we should really cry for the next generation, because they have been born in corruption. They have been raised in corruption. They have witnessed corruption. And so before them, corruption is a normal thing, which is very deadly. So,
can you wind up our viewers?
I want to take this opportunity to appreciate you, Dr. Juko, for having me once again. I want to appreciate my fellow panelists. I want to appreciate you, my brother Lawrence, for the bright mind that you have always shared with us, especially regarding the issues of Africa, regarding particularly the issues concerning our mother country, Uganda. I want to appreciate our viewers and our listeners, especially those of you from Uganda, please. Uganda is our motherland, and it is our cardinal responsibility to ensure that we give Uganda the right direction it should take, especially those of us who are 35 years and above. We are so much interested in this country, first of all, to give it the right direction during our time, and also to prepare a very good platform and right indicators that can take this country to another generation that will benefit the next generation, which will cover our children and then our children's children. So may the Lord God bless you. Have a blessed evening from Uganda. And once again, I'm Stephen Owor.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, Stephen, for the wonderful analysis that you've given us this evening. And we believe it has been a pleasure having you. And we are starting a new year. We have a lot we're going to give to our people. So thank you very much. Happy New Year. God bless you as well. Let me have Lawrence. Lawrence, the same question goes to you, Lawrence. What are your three trending stories, the interesting stories that among those that we have discussed? And then from there, you will say goodbye to our viewers.
Well, thank you so much, Nadine. for that question. Well, I think my biggest stories don't differ so much from what my brother Steve of Aurora has just, you know, elaborated. And I would, maybe let me not focus on the stories. Let me just focus on the biggest three issues that I look at. When I look at the stories that have trended mostly this year, I think there is a lot of loss of life. We seem to have lost so much life this year, starting from the, you know, the elections, which, you know how many people are claimed. Some people on the campaign trail just burying people every other week or every other day. That was not a very pleasant picture to have, more so at the beginning of the year, like right now we've just started another one. When you look at the personalities that have died, the head of the Catholic Church is dead, the head of the Orthodox Church is dead, we have sheikhs going out, then that is in addition to, you know, all these the terrorist attacks that we had, people lost their lives in there. We have an attempt on the general's life, General Katumba, and again, you know, the driver dies and the daughter dies. When you look at that, even more so when you look at, yes, ADF launching attacks into Congo, it's not for fun. That is more life loss that is guaranteed by some of those actions. So when you look at it, I feel like we are making so many losses as a country and as a region, and this is very worrying. And some of it is from actions that we could so much avoid. I mean, you know, things that we could take some action on such that they, you know, they don't happen. If people are more responsible, if people really love their country, I don't think they would go out of their way to, you know, end other people's lives. If their concerns are taken care of, then maybe you wouldn't have fronts that are thinking of violence and things of a nature. So it is a responsibility, again, back to Ugandans to try to safeguard their life. But for me, the number one issue is loss of life. And of course, moving on to the next issue, I think it's the issue of justice. Justice in the stories that, you know, that came out, when you look at how was the petition handled, you know, the electoral commission, the electoral petition, how was it handled? I think there was a lot of exposés that happened during those deliberations, that the justice was exposed as not really being independent. It's very worrying. When it comes to issues of land, you know, land issues and the tenure system, and you saw all those cases that the commission handled, it still goes back to, you know, the Justice League. How can we do better to, you know, give Ugandans more confidence into the temple of justice that they can run to it? Like I just told you, the judiciary is running at 90% land issues, but only, you know, 5% are making it to, you know, some kind of court system, and of which only 1% is having a lawyer involved. That means that there's a lot of education that needs to go on to get the masses to trust you, you know, more and involve you into seeking justice. That's my second issue. The Justice League really needs to pull up its socks come this year and maybe the next 5 years and beyond. And of course, my brother's talked about how the Electoral Commission needs to be, you know, reorganized such that we can have, you know, a better election sprint next time, and maybe outcome which doesn't have to have all these court cases that come up and people's crying foul play at the end of the day. And of course, lastly, the last issue is the regional issue in as far as where Uganda is and where it wants to see itself in maybe, you know, like the president's vision 2040. And for some Ugandans, maybe they are looking to more years than 2040 or something bigger than that. There's been a lot of talk of where the country should be and which, you know, kind of nation we want to, you know, reflect or leave to the coming generation. Because as much as right now we have the incumbent right now at 80 years or 75 years plus, and all these people within government who are also averaging within the 50-year mark plus, Uganda still has the highest population being really, really young. And these people have not been given the opportunity to participate in leadership, for starters. They've been economically disempowered. Their resources are getting pulled right under their feet, like you're seeing with all these land grabbings and so on. What is the vision internally as Uganda? What do we really want to see? I think we want to see or do better. And it's so interesting that all these personalities think they're doing something good, but at the end of the day, when it comes out, it usually doesn't come out as pleasant. And of course, now it is how we are positioning ourselves in the region. We have all these trading partners within Congo, you know, Kenya, Tanzania, Rwanda. I think we do have something with Burundi. Now we're trying to build a bridge in the DRC. Now, the bigger question is, with all these stories that have come with us launching an offensive in the DRC, at the same time we are building roads. The Rwanda border is closed. The Sudanese are attacking our traders. We pull the oil pipeline deal from Kenya and then push it down to Tanzania. All these actions at the end of the day, are they really going to create the kind of future that we want to see the next generation take? It's a question that you and I can pose to yourself, and of course you have your answer and I have mine. I'm not so certain we are building a very stable ship moving forward, but it's not too late. It's a work in progress. Nation building is a constant effort. It never stops. Every time words fly around, concerns will come up. There will be wins, there will be losses, but most importantly, what determines how far we are going to go, or anyone will ever go, is whether you pay attention to those concerns that could, take you off the course. And I hope people out there are listening, more so the viewers, and those who are in certain positions of power, per se, to take these concerns as though their life depends on it, and that they come from people who are just hoping and wishing to have or to see a better reality in Uganda. So those are my three issues. I've just tried to go through all the stories and just put them around those three. But other than that, for me, I do, of course, applaud our listeners who have been with us all the way from, the beginning of the year or even before, and who continue to listen to us. Thank you very much for always being ever present. And of course, all the panelists and all the guests that we've had on the show, thank you so much. And we hope to see you again on more, fruitful discussions and topical discussions on issues. And lastly, of course, is to thank just the whole UNN board and team for coming up with this initiative that is adding to our nation positively in terms of, giving out information, educating people on pertinent issues, and among other issues. Thank you so much, Nadine, and Dr. Samson, from our producer. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Lawrence. Thank you very much, Stephen. And actually, it has been a very interesting discussion tonight. As you know, our role as the media is to make sure that we enlighten the public about all these, and then the public can be able to, to pick their guts and try to fight for their freedom. It's all about life. It's all about the resolution of the year. It's all about that drive within ourselves that is going to make Uganda the best. Uganda, as we've heard, has gone through a lot this year, and we hope that with our efforts, we are going to see Uganda having a better kind of system, kind of environment that it undergoes through. We thank you very much, our viewers, for all the time that you have been with us ever since we started this program. And we thank very much your effort. We believe everything is going to be wow this new year. And we believe our lives and our economic kind of status is going to improve. Let's work hard and make sure that we have something in our pockets
let's work together. Unity is the source of victory. Unity should be the factor for all those forces that look for change in Uganda. I'll try to be in the center of all those discussions, bringing together a lot of other people that we can have a discussion and have a unified force. Thank you, our viewers. Thank you very much, Lawrence. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Samson, our producer, and the entire UNN team. Thank you, Principal, for bringing this initiative, and we believe it has helped a lot, and we believe we shall work teeth and nails to make sure that it produces the best for the people. We wish you a new year and a prosperous one with a lot of blessings from the heaven, and we wish a very good evening and new week as we try to see how the new year goes. Thank you very much. God bless you, and God bless everybody.